always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace. Our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for.
Today's lectionary is situated dramatically in the context of the festival of Passover, preceded by events such as Jesus' raising of Lazarus, Mary's anointing of Jesus' feet, and the triumphal entry of Jesus into Jerusalem. The responses to these events are intensely divided as crowds of people form to hear Jesus, while others plot to destroy him, and some disciples become more reverent, while within the heart of one of them, Judas, irritation escalates. Momentum builds in the narrative by the anonymous author of the fourth gospel as all eyes, including those of some Gentiles, strive to focus on Jesus. The scene is strikingly shaped for a powerful statement by Jesus to his disciples regarding not only what is to happen, but also what it means. I invite you to listen now as Jesus tries to tell them what his mission really is. This reading is from the Gospel of John, chapter 12, verses 20 through 33. Now among those who went up to worship at the festival were some Greeks. They came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, and said to him, "Sir, we wish to see Jesus." Philip went and told Andrew. Then Andrew and Philip went and told Jesus. Jesus answered them, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly I tell you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains just a single grain. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Those who love their life will lose it, and those who hate their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, there will my servant be also. Whoever serves me, the Father will honor. Now my soul is troubled, and what should I say? Father, save me from this hour? No, it is for this reason that I have come to this hour. Father, glorify your name. I have glorified it, and I will glorify it again." Said a voice from heaven. The crowd standing there heard it and said that it was thunder. Others said, "An angel has spoken to him." Jesus answered, "This voice has come for your sake, not for mine. Now is the judgment of this world. Now the ruler of this world will be driven out. And I, when I am lifted up from earth, will draw all people to myself." He said this to indicate the kind of death he was to die.
Thank you, Jody. May God grant us wisdom and understanding. What I'm about to say about Jesus' crucifixion and its implications for the church might be new or surprising to some of you. Today's text is not concerned with the forgiveness of individual sins. So you won't hear anything about Jesus' death on a cross, preventing divine punishment on those of us who deserve that on account of our individual sins. There's no allusion to sacrificial atonement. Instead, Jesus' crucifixion judges the world and drives out the rulers of the world. So the work of the cross is about taking on the system. And it's kind of where I got the title for today's message. Jesus' crucifixion judges the system that's opposed to God. And that system is driven by a spirit. It's driven by a force, which John's gospel refers to as the ruler of the world. The ruler of the world. And how does that ruler rule? By domination and violence and death. So today's text essentially describes an exorcism, a deliverance in which that oppressive system is judged and condemned by the very act of the crucifixion. So what's the work of the cross? It casts out the driving force, the ruler of the system that seeks to separate us from God. Well, what are we talking about here when we talk about system? We're talking about that which woos us down a path of death rather than life. And for some, you know, it takes on different forms. For some, it's the path of consumerism, you know, where you think it's all about acquiring and achieving, and the more stuff you get, you know, the one at the end that has the most stuff wins. And so often we see that which we consume can so easily consume us, possess us. And we know that ultimately consumption, a life of me, 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 really is not much life at all. For some, the path of death is the path of domination. Did you hear about the Catholic priest this past week in Italy who was handed a poison chalice? Jody, we're going to have to be careful. Yeah, handed a poison chalice. Here's a picture of him. That's Reverend Felice Palomera, who's known for bravely denouncing the organized crime. And he noticed while he was getting ready, he noticed the smell of bleach coming from the containers of water and wine during Mass last Saturday in Sensiniti in the southern region of Calabria. And that's where the powerful Drangheta crime network runs about a $72 billion enterprise. That's where it originated, right there. So talking about taking on the system, this guy has courage. Palomera suspected that something was wrong, and he immediately suspended the service, and he called the Italian National Police, the Carabinieri. Is that how you say it? Anyway, those of you who've been there, maybe you know how to pronounce it. The police later determined Palomera's cruets of water and wine had been laced with bleach. Kill the priest. He's taking on the system. So the path of domination perpetuates not only corruption, organized crime, but all kinds of things. Racism, sexism, heterosexism, ageism, and countless other oppressive isms. And such forms of domination even attempt to strip individual rights and freedoms. Can you imagine? In the name of religion and ideology. Watch the political spin speed up as we draw near to November 5th. Of course, there's more to this system than domination and consumerism. Jesus also takes on the myth of redemptive violence. According to this myth, the way to bring order out of chaos is through violently defeating the other. How do you deal with threats from the enemy? The myth says, well, you violently eliminate them. And if there's collateral damage and tens of thousands of innocent civilians are displaced, denied aid, and killed, so be it. And it's not just something that happens over there somewhere, overseas, right? I mean, we see the myth of redemptive violence at work today. It is prevalent right here in our own culture. We see it in movies. We see it in video games. Our children and grandchildren are immersed in it from a very young age. I'm just curious, how many of you grew up playing Cowboys and Indians? I know it's not PC to say anymore, but yeah, all right. Woo, all right, I'm safe. I can share this and you won't be looking at me like a deer in the headlights. I played it. That's what we called it, Cowboys and Indians. The Cowboys were the good guys. And when my brothers and I drew straws to who had to be the Indian, you know, if you got the Indian, you lost because you were always going to die and the Cowboys were always going to win. And do they make cap guns anymore for kids? No. Well, I loved my cap gun. I'll confess, I did. I loved it. And I was steeped in it. Violence from a young child. That's what you do. You shoot and kill those who are here before you. My brothers and I never understood as children the violence committed against Native Americans. Never even crossed our minds that maybe we were the bad guys and they were the good guys that stewarded well the environment. I mistakenly thought that Robert De Niro would get the Oscar last Sunday for Killers of the Flower Moon, a movie that reveals just how evil and blind humans can be when steeped in a culture of redemptive violence. Now, my dad is a retired Army colonel, and one of my favorite childhood gifts was a set of Army fatigues. I mean, that was about the best present I could hope for as a kid. I got that. It even came with a helmet and a toy gun. And Hogan's Heroes, which dates me, but does anybody remember Hogan's Heroes? All right, whew, all right, good, in good company here. Hogan's Heroes was filmed right here in L.A., but when I watched that TV show as a kid, I was transported to Nazi Germany. And how ironic that one of my favorite childhood shows was all about American prisoners of war outsmarting their captors. It's especially difficult to imagine an alternative to the myth of redemptive violence when we've been steeped in it since childhood. God only knows the detrimental impact of today's violent video games and movies on future generations. And the fact that they're still so popular as ever betrays how captive our society still is to the power of this myth of redemptive violence. Last Sunday, Ludwig Göransson accepted his, I think I have a picture of him, hopefully. There we go. Accepted his second Academy Award for his score to Oppenheimer. Anybody see Oppenheimer? If you haven't, you need to see it. Yeah. And he did it in a heartfelt speech thanking his parents for encouraging him to pursue music. He said, "Thank you for giving me guitars and drum machines instead of video games." Wow, what a powerful countercultural statement. Throughout Jesus' journey to the cross, he moves against the cultural norms of his day. He never succumbs to the myth of redemptive violence. He refuses to respond violently to the system opposed to God's purposes. And the same is true about the almost poisoned priest. Palomera said this, "My revenge is love, my shield forgiveness, my armor mercy." I'm in awe of some of these people today that stand in the face of tremendous violence and speak truth to power. I'm in awe. Now, in his trial before Pilate, Jesus suggested that violence is central to the system. And he rejects the system with these words, "My kingdom is not from this world. If my kingdom were from this world, my followers would be fighting." There's that violent word, fighting, "to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not from here." So Jesus' rejection of violence distinguishes his way from the way of the system. And on the cross, Jesus exposes the system for what it is. It is not the way of life. It is the way of death. And by exposing this system in this way, you could say that Jesus, or at least John, the author of John's gospel, says that Jesus casts out its driving spirit. So once we've seen the system, our eyes are opened, we're enlightened, we see the system for what it is, despite the fact maybe we were steeped in it as children, we now see it as it is, then we can begin to be liberated from its captivating ways. Like Jesus, Martin Luther King Jr. brilliantly understood how to take on the system in a nonviolent way. When the white powers that be turned hoses and dogs on the marchers, violent images were broadcast on TV nationwide, and the reality of white racism was graphically and publicly exposed for all to see in all its gruesome horror and ugliness. King knew exactly what he was doing. He said in this, a 1957 speech to marchers, "This willingness to suffer and this refusal to hit back will soon cause the oppressor to become ashamed of his own methods. You will leave him glutted with his own barbarity. You will force him to stand before the world and his God splattered with the blood and reeking with the stench of his Negro brother," end quote. King knew it was necessary to bring these issues to the surface, to bring them out into the open where everybody could see them. Now, anyone who would claim a politician today is worthy of being deemed superior to Martin Luther King, certainly that person would not have a history, a long history, of controversial comments about homosexuality, about religion, about victims of sexual abuse. Anyone who would dare to say that this is a Martin Luther King on steroids would certainly be lifting up someone who exposes the system of domination rather than serving as its pawn in a game of dominance. Martin Luther King Jr. exposed the spirit of racism, which began to lose some of its power over many people. And this is what happens on the cross. Jesus exposes the system, and by exposing it, he judges it, and in John's words, he casts it out. Well, you might say, well, Pastor Mike, come on, is consumerism still a threat today? Yes. Well, Pastor Mike, doesn't domination still play a critical role in our world? Well, it sure does. And furthermore, isn't the myth of redemptive violence still destroying thousands, tens of thousands, millions of people? Yes. Tragically, yes. Then how can you possibly agree with the author of the Gospel of John in his claim that Jesus' crucifixion cast out the ruler of the world? Isn't the system just as strong as it ever was? Fair question. Fair question. Yet change needs to begin somewhere, right? For Jesus, it begins by exposing and demystifying the demonic powers of the system. I'm talking about the social and psychological structures opposed to God and the life that God wants for all of us. And there is no quick fix, sadly. There's no quick fix. But we must continue, I believe. We must continue Christ's work by progressively delegitimizing a system that's opposed to God. What does this require of us? Well, Jesus offers a jarring proverb. Grains of wheat must, in a sense, die to what they are if they're not to remain alone and fruitless. So Jesus completes his mission as he sacrifices his own life in part to begin tearing down the walls of a system built on a myth of redemptive violence, domination, and greed. If you haven't seen Netflix Turning Point, I highly recommend it. There's a fantastic historical, journey that includes the tearing down of the Berlin Wall. It's the church's job to make sense of the cross. The great irony is the cross judges the myth of redemptive violence. And yet for over 2,000 years, many theologians have claimed that Jesus' death on the cross was an act of sacrifice on the order of blood offering to an angry and offended God. A violent price exacted in order to reverse the penalty of our sin. There are many different forms of atonement, but that's the one you hear quite often, sacrificial atonement. And if you don't believe that, well, you can't be a faithful Christian. I beg to differ. For many progressive Christians, this theory of sacrificial atonement does not adequately reflect the God revealed in and by Jesus Christ, a God of mercy, a God of love. Regardless of one's view of atonement, within this mystery of salvation and ultimate glory comes a message, I think, for all of us today. Like Jesus, we also must die. We must die to a love for our own lives, lest in loving them above all else, we lose them. Some spend their lives thinking the meaning of life. I was asked that question recently at the theater board. What's the meaning of life, Pastor Mike? Some spend their lives thinking the meaning of life is to consume. Yet the more they consume, the more their possessions consume them. Some find the ultimate meaning in life by getting ahead, becoming the highest in your corporation or in your, you know, becoming the boss, being able to dominate, being able to lord it over other people. Yet the more they seek power and control, you know anybody like this? The more they seek power and control over others, the more that power corrupts and destroys them. Some are so steeped in redemptive violence that they're not even aware of the influence over them. What must God think of our unquestioned wars and bias toward violence as a solution to violence? When will we get it? Into this world of consumerism and domination and redemptive violence comes Jesus. Ironically, called the Prince of Peace. The Prince of Peace. Jesus takes a higher road, a path that leads to life, not death. Ironically, he gives his life so that we can be on that path of life and have it abundantly. So what does this way of life look like? Ironically, it looks like a seed that dies in order to bear fruit. What does that mean for us? Well, it means death must precede life. We must hate a life that's opposed to God, that loves a world, a system that's bent on disobeying God's vision for this world. A system that seeks to alienate us from each other, demonize each other. We must hate a life that loves a world like that. We must hate our own complicity in a system that alienates us from God and each other through consumerism and domination and the myth of redemptive violence. Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. delivered a powerful speech in support of the striking sanitation workers at Mason Temple in Memphis, Tennessee on April 3rd, 1968. That date's important, isn't it? Because the very next day he was assassinated. And before he was assassinated, I'm going to close my message with what closed his speech that day. And this speech reminds me of Alexei Navalny. We stand in awe of some of the most courageous and bold people today speaking truth to power. Here it is. Well, I don't know what will happen now. We've got some difficult days ahead, but it doesn't matter with me now because I've been to the mountaintop and I don't mind. Like anybody, I would like to live a long life. Longevity has its place, but I'm not concerned about that now. I just want to do God's will. And he's allowed me to go up to the mountain, and I've looked over, and I've seen the promised land, and I might not get there with you, but I want you to know tonight that we as a people will get to the promised land, and I'm happy tonight. I'm not worried about anything. I'm not fearing any man, mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. Would you pray with me? Gracious God, we stand in awe of the courage of Jesus, who took on the myth of redemptive violence. We stand in awe of Martin Luther King Jr., Alexei Navalny, a priest in Italy. There's so many different examples in our life of people risking it all to speak truth to power. God, we know this change in this world that's so bent on war begins with that small little change of awakening and seeing perhaps even within ourselves our own complicity within this system. Guide us and direct us, O God, in the way of life. And if we fear being that seed that gets buried in the soil, may we trust in you to see us through transformation so that we may bear fruit. Amen. Amen. Thank you.